Je voudrais du soleil vert, des dentelles et des théières, des photos de bord de mer, dans mon jardin d'hiver. Je voudrais de la lumière, comme en Nouvelle-Angleterre. Je veux changer d'atmosphère, dans mon jardin d'hiver.
Madam Speaker, I recognize myself for the remainder of our time.
Gentlemen's recognized.
Madam Speaker, my colleagues, after 8 hours, let us return to where we began with the articles themselves. Article 1 charges the President of the United States with abusing the power of his office by coercing an ally into cheating in a U.S. election on his behalf. It charges the President of the United States.
Be in order. The gentleman has a right to be heard.
It charges the President of the United States.
The gentleman shall suspend. Gentleman may resume.
It charges the President of the United States with his abusing his power by withholding official acts, by withholding a White House meeting that the President of Ukraine desperately sought to establish the support of his most important benefactor, the United States, by withholding hundreds of millions of dollars of military aid to a nation at war in order to get that nation to intervene in our election by smearing his opponent. That is the gravamen of the charge in Article 1. And what is the defense from my colleagues? Now, I've listened carefully to my colleagues for the last 8 hours, and I have to say it's been hard for me to follow. But it amounts, I think, when you cut through it all, when you cut through all the sound and the fury signifying nothing, what it really amounts to is this. Why should we care? Why should we care about what the president did to Ukraine? Well, first of all, we should care about our allies. We should care about Ukraine. We should care about a country struggling to be free and a democracy. We used to care about democracy. We used to care about our allies. We used to stand up to Putin and Russia. We used to. I know the party of Ronald Reagan used to. Why should we care about Ukraine? But of course, it's about more than Ukraine. It's about us. It's about our national security. Their fight is our fight. Their defense is our defense. When Russia remakes the map of Europe for the first time since World War II by dint of military force, and Ukraine fights back, it is our fight too. And when the president sacrifices our interests, our national security, for his election, he is sacrificing our country for his personal gain. That is the gravamen of Article 1. Article 2 charges the President of the United States with obstructing the Congress, with denying the Congress any witness, any document, by telling all of his administration people, you will not appear. You will ignore a co-equal branch of government. And what is the defense to this from my colleagues? Again, it is, why should we care? He is the president of our party. Why should we care if he ignores this Congress? Well, I remind my friends that he will not be the last president. There will be another president. And you may be one day, although you do not act like it, you may one day be in the majority. And you will want to hold a president accountable. And what will you say when that president says, you are a paper tiger, you have no oversight, I can ignore your subpoenas? What will you say? What will you argue? Well, no, that was different. Then we were in the minority. Then it was a Republican president. Will that be your argument? Is that how little faith you have in our democracy, in our Constitution? Is that how poorly you defend and uphold that Constitution? But finally, let me ask this question that overrides it all. Why should we care about any of this? And I will bring you to one conversation that came to light, because it's not the most important conversation, but in many ways, it is the most revealing. It took place on September 14th in Ukraine, when Ambassador Volker sat down with Andrei Yermak, the top advisor to Zelensky. And he did what he should do. He supported the rule of law, and he said, you, Andrei Yermak, should not investigate the last president, President Poroshenko, for political reasons. You should not engage in political investigations. And you know what Yermak said? Oh, you mean like you want us to do with the Bidens and the Clintons? And in that abrupt, brutal retort, we see why we should care. Because what he was saying is, you, America, have forgotten what it means to uphold the rule of law. You have forgotten what it means to say that no one is above the law. We are a struggling democracy, but even we know better than that. What is at risk here? What is at risk here is the very idea of America. That idea holds that we are a nation of laws, not of men. We are a nation that believes in a rule of law. When we say we uphold the Constitution, we are not talking about a piece of parchment. We're talking about a beautiful architecture in which ambition is set against ambition, in which no branch of government can dominate another. That is what it means to uphold the Constitution. If you ignore it, if you say the president may refuse to comply, may refuse lawful process, may coerce an ally, may cheat in an election because he's the president of our party, you do not uphold our Constitution. You do not uphold your oath of office. Well, I will tell you this. I will uphold mine. I will vote to impeach Donald Trump. I yield back.
It is Thursday, the 19th of December of 2019, and you are in West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. I am your chef de cuisine, Justice Putnam, and our daily special is Metro Shrimp and Grits Thursdays. A little bit of jambalaya, a little bit of spice in your life. Indeed. Well, the big news, a lot of people think the big news is about impeachment. And Nancy, oh gosh, she is so smart. And I think she read Lawrence Tribe and a few other people, because apparently she's just going to hold those articles until Mitch McConnell comes to heel, or at least tell us what the hell they're going to do. Smart as a whip. Already I'm getting on Facebook the Russian agitprop about how, the Democrats are going to suffer. Actually, I think that it will be the Vichy repugs who suffer at the polls. For those left, because apparently a lot of them are quitting now, Mark Meadows has decided to drop out of his race and, become an aide to Donald Trump. They're going to go down with the ship until just the very end, and then all the rats will jump off, as they always do. So, Mark Meadows, chalk that one up. It could be that a lot of repugs are going to be just getting out of the game. Because who wants to be put onto the stone annals of history for all to know forever. Just remember, Trump may not be removed, but he is impeached today. He is impeached tomorrow. He is impeached forever. Indeed. Okay. Well, everybody thinks that's the big news. But really what the big news is the great Daily Kos image library purge. Yeah, apparently because of copyright problems and whatever, you know, DKOS has had to purge a lot of our images. I got to say, including images that I have took off of my own analog camera, transferred and into a digital format and posted online. Images, pictures that I've actually shown in art shows. Photographs that have been held for 20, 30 years are now suddenly verboten. Even a photograph that Nita Lind took of me at Daily Kos headquarters for the third presidential debate. That was way back. That was way, way back. That wasn't 2016, okay? We're talking Obama. Mm-hmm. And, my gosh, I understand it, but now it's going to be some sort of process to get my images back up so I can use them. I post a lot of images on the Show Notes and Links diary because when they gave us that feature, they encouraged us to use it. And I did. And rather than go through the problems of having, you know, images from out in the world that might be difficult. I mean, even if you attribute them, sometimes they don't want you using them, even from like museums or from newspapers or what have you. So rather than use those, I used my own because they're mine. But now I guess, of course, you know, I didn't do the thing about putting a little watermark somewhere on my photographs. But I guess that's what I got to do now. Figure out how to do that because I don't want to go into it. But is that bigger news than impeachment? No, but it is a concern. And I do understand why Daily Kos has to do it. But what a chore. I suppose I can just use no images, and because it is truly only a Show Notes and Links diary, I thought I'd be a little entertaining, have a little bit of a flow, have some other things on there like quotes and poetry and just what have you. I even had a picture of the old crystal radios that we used to get back in the 60s when I was just a little kid. Can't have that now either. Apparently somebody thinks that that's a copyright infringement. Okay. Well, we'll see. We'll see if they take the AP photos away and the UPI photos away of Vietnam. It's going to be really tough. I think on Black Kos, it's going to be really tough. Of course, just as a reminder, I am the poetry editor on Black Kos. We are on vacation right now. So when we get back, I'm thinking Dopper and Denise and Chi-Town Kev and Cepheus, we're going to have to figure out what the hell to do when we can't post images anymore. Because most of Black Kos is images that you get out in the world. And apparently those images out in the world we can't use anymore. Unless they come from Getty. Then you can use them. That's not Daily Kos' fault. But what an oddity in today's new agogo world, isn't it? Considering that every bit of data about me can be sold without my permission because it is implied consent by dint of the fact that I'm online. But something that I own, something that I would like to feature, something that I created as art, apparently, I can't post because of a copyright infringement. Give me a break. All right. Well, they had to do a blanket purge. I understand that. And I'm not the only one who has had their images that they have created themselves taken off. Well, I am in line in the help desk with a ticket. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to go off on that. But let me get back to the impeachment issue because the Russian agitprop is working overtime now. Boy, I had like an 8 paragraph post I posted on Twitter and also on my Facebook page and a couple of Southern Oregon Facebook community groups, a picture of my son, my granddaughter, and a couple of my nieces on the steps of the Oregon State Capitol a year ago this last summer, doing two things. One, protesting the icebox baby gulags, and also the Proud Boys who thought that they were going to be able to take over the Oregon State Capitol. So my son went out there with a bullhorn, and he's a big guy. He taught boxing, heavyweight. He could, you know, he's a heavyweight, big, 6'2", I don't know what, 220 or so. He's a big kid. But he was out there, and yeah, some might say, well, you had your nieces and granddaughter were there. Well, you know, yeah. Because they were protesting icebox baby gulags with a big sign and the American flag. And the sign said, what if it was your kids? And a vote for Trump was a vote for hate. What was wrong with you? And that, my son, two nieces, and my granddaughter kept the Proud Boys at bay while at the same time protesting icebox baby gulags. So I posted that image. And because before my son had passed, you know, we had talked about all of this that was going on. And I assured him, I promised him, he's going to get impeached. And I explained what impeachment and removal means and how difficult it would be to remove Donald Trump. But impeachment is forever. So I posted that image of my son on the steps of the Oregon State Capitol with my granddaughter and two nieces and said, well, you know, I promised him, and now that is one promise fulfilled. The other promise is that, well, I'm hoping to keep it. But I am working hard now to put this guy in jail. So, of course, I on my own personal Facebook page, I had like an 8-paragraph Russian ad. It just hit every single trope. George Soros, you know, we're going to lose at the polls. We're going to be made fun of. Trump is going to be president forever, and Democrats are at fault. And I just retorted, oh, what was the other one? You know, we haven't done anything. We're all about impeachment and haven't done anything with legislation, you know, child trafficking. And it's just batshit crazy bullshit. And all I did was post the 400 bills, 90% of which are bipartisan, sitting in the Senate in Mitch McConnell's graveyard about the do-nothing Dems. Yeah, 400 bills counting, and Moscow Mitch won't let them come to a vote. That's not on us. It will be the Vichy Repugs who suffer at the polls. I want to see the advertisement of each and every one of those voting, the Democrats with the American flag waving behind them, and then every time a Republican vote came in, I would like to see an image of Putin superimposed behind them. I want to see that ad. We are going to suffer at the polls? No. The Republicans are jumping ship. They're not even going to run. They know how bad it is. Well, what's on the rest of the menu here at the Bistro Cafe? Of West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy, of course. At the top, Adam Schiff's powerful closing in the impeachment debate is a speech for the ages, indeed. On the rest of the menu, the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals struck down the individual mandate part of Obamacare. But it's only going to give Democrats a line of attack against Trump and congressional Republicans. Trump rally-goers demanded Hillary be locked up minutes after he was impeached. Of course they did. And Trump economic aide Larry Kudlow, or is it Kudlow, admitted the Chinese prefer Trump over Democrats because he doesn't go on about human rights and those other stupid things. He doesn't. After the break, we then move to the chef's table, where in one of the world's worst single instances of election violence, a Philippine court found top members of a political clan guilty of the 2009 massacre of 57 people, among them 32 journalists. And a Slovak businessman, and three others, will appear in court for the murder of an investigative journalist and his fiancee that sparked massive protests against graft in the country. All that and more on West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. Bon appetit. Bottom of our homepage at netrootsradio.com. To the right-ish of the page is our chat room link, monitored by Kelly Lincoln. Thank you, Kelly. To the left-ish of the page, from our chat room link at the bottom of our homepage at netrootsradio.com, you will then notice the link to our Patreon page, and do please become a recurring Patreon of Netroots Radio. Your recurring contribution helps us pay our bills and the newish machinery that we are direly in need of, and we have been resisting as resistance radio for the last, well, 8 years and counting. We weren't always resisting because a lot of that was when Obama was president, but we were resisting the GOP and their obstruction. Yeah, Merrick Garland this, McConnell. Anyway, we have been doing this for quite a while, 24/7, 365, and we've been able to do it because of your generosity, which we still rely on, so thank you. If you would like to follow Netroots Radio on Twitter, go to @NetrootsRadio. Tom takes care of that, and we thank Tom. I take care of @JusticePutnam, which is a pretty good place to follow me. And I also post that show notes and links diary on Daily Codes about 10 minutes before showtime. Maybe a lot of the images will be gone. Maybe some of them will be there. But I do post that on social media for your show notes and links. Pleasure. Yes, indeed. And also, if you want to follow the show on Twitter, do so @CookbookWest and pick up podcasts by way of Spreaker, Stitcher, TuneIn, iHeart, YouTube, iTunes, and wherever podcasts can be found. All right, let's get into this first offering here in the Bistro Cafe of West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy, and it comes our way by anonymous worker bees at the Associated Press. The individual mandate of former President Barack Obama's health care law is invalid, but other parts of the law need further review, a federal appeals court ruled yesterday. Now, let's remember, the individual mandate is a right-wing Republican thing. They're the ones that insisted the individual mandate had to be part of a health care law when the health care law was known as Romney Care. But as soon as the black guy did Romney Care, they called it Obamacare and said the individual mandate was a violation of constitutional rights beyond compare. How dare that black guy make people have skin in the game? Which is what the Republicans kept saying, even Romney. We got to have people have skin in the game. That's where there's the individual mandate. Well, that is now considered unconstitutional, but of course, the rest of the law can stand, but it's going to be pushed through the courts as unconstitutional. And did you know that Mitch McConnell, during impeachment, pushed through another 13 judges? Federalist Society judges. The courts from top to bottom are being packed by the most virulent anti-democratic jurists. I can't even call them jurists because most of them aren't. They are rated so low by the ABA that they couldn't even be a lawyer. But Mitch McConnell is pushing them through because, well, they will never let another black president, woman or man, run this country again. That's why they need to go to jail. I am not necessarily into jailing political opponents, but Mitch McConnell has been a scourge on this democracy, and it looks like he's in cahoots with some hostile foreign actors, Dara Paska. Oh, and what was Bobby Long, just as another aside, what was Bobby Long doing there? Bobby Long, you know, one of the repugs, Vichy repugs that was there at the debate. He had $100 bills sticking out of his suit pocket. Firtash money delivered by Lev, probably to Rudy, and then Rudy passed it out. But Lev had to get it to Rudy. And Lev got it from Firtash. That was more telling than John Boehner, Boehner. When John Boehner was handing out tobacco lobby money in envelopes on the House floor. Firtash money sticking out of Bobby Long's suit coat pocket is a lot more telling. Firtash money. Let's remember that. The GOP is awash in laundered Russian rubles. And there was only one party that the NRA thought that they could get away with. And it wasn't the Democrats. Maybe a blue dog here and there. But do they count? No, like Tulsi, they'll just be present. Before I begin this next offering here in the Bistro Cafe of West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy, Metro Shrimp and Grits Thursdays, I want to mention on the previous story, the insurance aspect of the individual mandate was ruled unconstitutional by dint of the fact that Trump administration in 2017 made that tax down to zero. So it pretty much rendered the individual mandate moot. And they're trying to starve the ACA, of course. All right. All right. Because I just got off on the impeachment issue, but we have another story about the impeachment issue coming up. And it's out of the American Independent by the great Callie Joy Gray, who we interviewed quite a few times in the previous incarnation of West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy when it was called The After Show a long time ago. On Wednesday night, that was yesterday, last night, the House of Representatives impeached Donald Trump for abuse of power and obstruction of justice. Minutes later, at a Trump rally in Battle Creek, Michigan, his supporters broke into their all-too-familiar chant of lock her up, still demanding his 2016 opponent, Hillary Clinton, be imprisoned for the crime of being Hillary Clinton. And now I hear she wants to run again, Trump said, even though this baseless rumor has been repeatedly debunked. Wouldn't that be great? He looked heavenward as if in prayer. Oh, would we love that, he continued. You think the Democrats are screwed up? Wait till that happens. Then on cue, the crowd broke into its chant, lock her up. Trump, as usual, did not stop his fans from demanding Clinton be locked up. Instead, he gave them permission to continue their chant. Based on the FBI report, you just saw what happened with the IG. Where they came out with the FBI, they said, best on that, you know what? I never stopped you, but now think of what they did. The report Trump referenced did not find any wrongdoing by Clinton, nor give any reason why she might be charged for any crime, let alone be imprisoned. But that has not stopped Trump or his supporters. Meanwhile, multiple Trump campaign advisors have been charged, convicted, and sent to prison, including Rick Gates, who was sentenced to 45 days in jail this month. And Trump now faces a trial in the Senate for his alleged crimes. But of course, that's only when Mitch McConnell
admits that he's going to have to do the right thing.
Mitch McConnell doing the right thing? Only if it's right for Mitch McConnell. Bistro Cafe of West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy comes our way by Cody Fenwick out of Alternet. White House Director of Economic Policy Larry Kudlow made a stunning admission yesterday, Wednesday, as he was discussing Trump's trade negotiations with China. Eamon Javers, a CNBC journalist covering the economy, reported on the remarks Kudlow made to a group of reporters. Kudlow said that Henry Kissinger... Yes, Henry Kissinger. Get down on your knees, Henry, and pray. Henry Kissinger. President Richard Nixon's former Secretary of State had recently been to the White House, and he's also recently met with Chinese leader Xi Jinping twice. Well, well, well. Tell me more. I asked if Kissinger is playing a back-channel role in trade talks, Javers said. Well, now you're getting into the family jewels, Kudlow responded. Did anybody ask Kudlow, what is all that white stuff on your nose? No, they didn't. Well, that alone, not the cocaine up his nose, but the admission that they're getting into the family jewels when they're talking about if Kissinger has been playing a back-channel role. Well, you got Rudy, and now you got Henry. Kissinger has been persuasively accused of international war crimes as he enabled dictators and mass atrocities abroad. Having ties to Kissinger, let alone having him actively work to shape policy, should be toxic for any sitting politician, but we're talking about Trump, and he's a mobster. Of course, it's no secret that Trump does not care about human rights abuses in China. And why is that? Well, we know why, because, you know, there's a lot of shithole countries around there, and Trump is just transactional. He needs to do what's good for him. Kudlow said that President Xi told Kissinger that he would rather deal with Trump, who will focus more on trade and the economy, rather than Democrats who won't talk about key trade issues, but instead will go on and on and on about human rights and those other stupid things. Yeah, this is the way to promote democracy around the world, right? Send Larry Kudlow and Henry Kissinger? He added, now let me be careful here, this being Kudlow. President Trump made it very clear that we favor freedom and democracy and a peaceful solution in Hong Kong and that we oppose, of course, the maltreatment of Muslims and the Uyghurs. But, you know, does Trump really care about rights abuses in China or anywhere? Nothing about his moves on foreign policy or his public statements have given any indication that he genuinely cares about countering authoritarian regimes, promoting democracy, or empowering the rights of minorities. And Trump openly embraces and lauds brutal rulers like Xi, Putin, and Kim Jong-un, while often spurning the leaders of democratic allies of the United States. Well, yeah. Enemies, foreign and domestic. Not or. In this situation, it's not only foreign, but it is also domestic. A grave threat to our democracy. And we've taken a grave step in righting this terrible wrong that has been foisted upon us by hostile foreign powers and hostile
actors within our own United States who have been hostile to democracy for decades. All right, let's get to our break. And when we get back from that break, we are going to go through weather from around the world, and we are going to finish up with the stories that we have curated for you today. You are listening to West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy, and we will be right back.
You are listening to NetRootsRadio.com.
Please hang up and try again.
From a point at sea to the circles of your mind, a new force is at work for planetary transformation. New radio for a new earth.
This is Take Two Movie Review. I'm Clinton Johnston. This week, The Calm and Winding Road. Slight spoilers. In Queen and Slim, Daniel Kaluuya and Jodie Turner-Smith play Ernest Hines and Angela Johnson, a poorly matched couple who are out on a last-minute first date when they are stopped, bullied, and attacked by a cop. They're black, he's white, and accidentally while defending themselves, they shoot the cop and then flee, setting us up for a road romance crime film a la True Romance or Natural Born Killers or even Thelma and Louise. But that's not what we get. What we get instead is less of a chase and more of an odyssey, as the film languidly follows our duo through various episodes along their drive to freedom. And the episodes are dramatic and emotional, but they don't really build to much. At one point, Ernest says he doesn't drink, and then later on, he does. And it feels like that action is something, but thinking about it, we never learn why he doesn't drink, or what sobriety means to him, so we don't know how to feel when he casually throws it away. And a lot of the movie is like that, compelling actions and interactions that don't lead to an examination of a central theme or the development of a character. I mean, I'd like to say that this movie is more a character study than a plot beast, and don't get me wrong, Kaluuya and Turner-Smith are captivating to watch. Those introspective scenes with spare dialogue, they're right there. But though we get character backgrounds and beliefs, none of their core desires or tenets of personal philosophy are challenged. Hines and Johnson don't learn anything or overcome anything. They aren't appreciably different at the end of the film than at the beginning, other than that they've hooked up. He doesn't drink. He takes a drink. I mean, go see it. It's very watchable. But know what you're getting into. Queen and Slim isn't a movie that you follow. It's a movie that you sit with and let happen. This has been Take Two Movie Review. I'm Clinton Johnston. Catch up with us at TakeTwoMovieReview.com and feed us back on our page on YouTube.
This is Scientific American's 60-Second Science. I'm Christopher Intagliata. Go snorkeling in a lot of places, and you'll find coral. But on Israel's Mediterranean coast?
I think it's the only place in the world that you can find whole prehistoric villages submerged under the sea.
Ehud Galili is an underwater archaeologist at the University of Haifa. He says one submerged village, called Tel Hrez, sits 5 to 10 feet under the water. The community was populated some 7,000 years ago. There, the archaeologists have found pottery and flint, human skeletons, the remains of deer, cows, pigs, and dogs, and hundreds of olive pits, probably the remains of olive oil production. And the researchers also found a 300-foot-long stretch of huge boulders, a wall. After ruling out possible other uses for the wall, like defense against enemies or corralling animals, the scientists determined that the formation was actually an ancient seawall, the oldest known example in the world. The results are in the journal PLOS ONE. The boulders that kept the waters of the Mediterranean from flooding the village came from riverbeds a mile or two away, and the researchers say it would have taken multiple people or strong beasts of burden to move them into place, suggesting that constructing the wall was a well-organized community effort. But eventually, the sea beat the barrier.
Little by little, sea level continued to rise, and then it became no more effective. And at some point, the cost of continuing to struggle with the sea was too high economically, and they made a decision to abandon the village.
Of course, our technology is far more advanced than what they had 7 millennia ago. But this sunken seawall is still a warning of what can happen when humans battle rising seas. Thanks for listening. For Scientific American's 60-Second Science, I'm Christopher Intagliata.
This is an important message from the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. When it snows this winter, make sure you clear more than your driveway. Before you hit the road and before you get in the driver's seat, check to be sure that your vehicle's tailpipe is clear of snow. If the tailpipe is blocked, carbon monoxide, an odorless, colorless, and deadly gas produced by your engine, can build up quickly inside your vehicle, poisoning anyone inside. To learn more, call 1-800-CDC-INFO. That's 1-800-232-4636.
Sweetie, want some fruit?
You have to use the right tool for the job. A power drill is the wrong tool to slice fruit. Just like an antibiotic is the wrong tool to treat viruses, including colds and flu. Antibiotics are only needed for certain bacterial infections. When they aren't needed, antibiotics won't help you, and the side effects could still hurt you. Ask your healthcare professional when an antibiotic is the right tool and when it's not. Visit cdc.gov/antibiotic-use.
Hi, it's Tom. Could we humbly suggest your donation to netrootsradio.com? All we've got to run this 24-hour powerhouse of progressive resistance radio is what comes out of our own wallets and you. You are our biggest donor. And it doesn't take much, $3, $5. Just go to the bottom of our netrootsradio.com page and hit our secure donate button. Heck, you can even make a recurring contribution, and you'll get a wondiferous pair of Netroots radio stickers for application to your backpack, your bumper sticker, or your banjo. Well, it's up to you which backpack you want to put it on. So donate what you'd like at the bottom of our netrootsradio.com's homepage. Because you are our biggest donor. Netrootsradio.com. Together, we are Resistance Radio.
I'm Rick Smith, and this is Labor History in Two. On this day in labor history, the year was 1983. That was the day that a bitter national strike of Greyhound workers came to a close. Nearly 13,000 bus drivers, mechanics, and clerks had gone on strike. They were members of the Amalgamated Transit Union. Contract negotiations had gotten off to a foreboding start that year. The company had demanded deep cuts in both wages and benefits. At the same time, management was set to receive a 10% wage increase. Deregulation in the industry had resulted in a rise of low-fare, non-unionized bus companies. But even with that, Greyhound was still making a profit. ATU members voted overwhelmingly to reject management's proposal. That November, they went out on strike. Greyhound responded by bringing in scab workers to drive the buses. The news media, including Dan Rather at CBS News, reported on the development.
Violence and the threat of violence rode the nation's highways today as Greyhound resumed limited bus service in the midst of a bitter strike. Police listed more than 100 arrests around the country.
In Zanesville, Ohio, bringing in strike breakers led to tragedy. One of these scab drivers plowed his bus through a line of union picketers. One of the strikers, Ray Phillips, was hit and killed. Ray was a steward and former president of his local union. No one was ever held accountable for the killing of Ray Phillips. The strike ended with the workers taking a nearly 8% pay cut. They also lost vacation days and saw a reduction in their benefits. It was another bitter defeat for labor in the same year that saw President Ronald Reagan bust the Air Traffic Controllers Union. From the skies to the roads, American workers were and continue to be under attack. Today's Labor History in Two brought to you in memory of Carol Hillman, a passionate friend of workers and volunteer of the Illinois Labor History Society and the Rick Smith Show.
I read the news today, oh boy.
It's time for Nicole Sandler's What's News from NicoleSandler.com and the Progressive Voices Network.
On this vote, the yeas are 229, the nays are 198, present is one. Article 2 is adopted.
Donald John Trump, the 45th President of the United States, has been impeached. As of 8:32 p.m. Eastern Time on Wednesday, December 18th, 2019. The final tallies, 230 votes in favor of Article 1, abuse of power, with 197 against and one present. For Article 2, obstruction of Congress, the count was 229 for, 198 against, and 1 present. The votes came down, as you'd expect, along party lines with a few exceptions. As expected, Jeff Van Drew of New Jersey joined with the Republicans in voting no and is expected to make it official, as he said he'll switch parties too. To that, we say good riddance. Colin Peterson has been representing Minnesota's quite conservative 7th District for 7 terms now. He also voted no on both counts. And it was Jared Golden of Maine who split his vote, siding with the Democrats on Article 1, abuse of power, but against Article 2, obstruction of Congress? Yeah, go figure that one. And Tulsi Gabbard, allegedly still a Democratic presidential candidate, voted present. Independent Justin Amash, who was a staunch Republican before his criticisms of Trump had him driven out of the party, voted yes. The next step is for the Speaker of the House to send the articles of impeachment over to the Senate for a trial to determine whether Trump will be removed from office or acquitted. At a press conference following the impeachment vote, Nancy Pelosi responded to questions about the idea of holding the articles back from the Senate as long as Mitch McConnell insists he won't hold a fair trial.
We have legislation approved by the Rules Committee that will enable us to decide how we will send over the articles of impeachment. We cannot name managers until we see what the process is on the Senate side, and I would hope that that will be soon, as we did with our legislation, our Resolution 660, to describe what the process would be. So far, we haven't seen anything that looks fair to us, so hopefully it will be fairer. And when we see what that is, we'll send our
managers. Can I follow up? So you would withhold, you would wait to send the articles until you understand what the Senate's going to do?
We'll make a decision as a group, as we always have, as we go along.
Pelosi's concerns are well-founded, as McConnell has admitted he will not be an impartial juror, and those are the actual words contained in the oath he'd have to swear as a juror in a Senate impeachment trial.
I'm not an impartial juror. This is a political process. There's not anything judicial about it. Impeachment is a political decision.
McConnell took to the Senate floor Thursday morning, where he slammed the impeachment and accused the Democrats of backpedaling, saying that Pelosi, quote, suggested that House Democrats may be too afraid to even transmit their shoddy work product to the Senate. These are from his prepared remarks, which also show he has the gall to say, quote, the framers built the Senate to provide stability, to keep partisan passions from boiling over. Moments like this are why the United States Senate exists. And statements like that are why I came up with the term opposite world. Welcome to it. As for the calendar, the Senate will adjourn for the holidays by the end of the week, and the House is out after Thursday, so a delay of at least a few weeks is expected. Stay tuned. Now, before they leave for the holidays, there are still a few items of business for Congress to complete. The House will follow up impeachment by passing Trump's top legislative priority, the USMCA. The Senate still has to pass government funding. While we were watching the impeachment proceedings on Wednesday, the Fifth Circuit Court ruled the individual mandate of the Affordable Care Act unconstitutional and remanded it back to the district court. Understand that the Trump administration is still doing its damnedest to strip health care from women, people with disabilities, LGBTQ people, and everyone who was previously denied coverage due to pre-existing conditions. But wait, there's more. Yeah, while we weren't watching part two, Mitch McConnell forced a deal with Democrats to expedite 11 more federal district judge nominations. Thursday morning, Mark Meadows of North Carolina announced that he'll retire from Congress at the end of this term. A big Trump ally who co-founded the Freedom Caucus, Meadows says he'll work for Trump's campaign or perhaps even in the administration. And finally, 7 of the remaining Democratic candidates vying for the nomination returned to the debate stage Thursday night in Los Angeles. They are Joe Biden, Bernie Sanders, Elizabeth Warren, Pete Buttigieg, Andrew Yang, Amy Klobuchar, and Tom Steyer. Hosted by PBS and Politico, the debate will also air on CNN beginning at 8 p.m. Eastern Time. And that's just a bit of what's news for now. I'm Nicole Sandler. If you appreciate these reports and the Nicole Sandler Show, I hope you'll consider making a contribution. My work is 100% listener supported, and I can't do it without your help. Find out more at NicoleSandler.com. Please click on that donate button.
Thank you for accompanying us here to the Chef's Table at West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. Metro Shrimp and Grits Thursdays. We always begin weather from around the world. Along the banks of the Rogue River and the Rogue River Valley of Southern Oregon on the west coast of the continental United States of America, where it is currently, 38 degrees Fahrenheit. We're expected to have a high of about 48. Cloudy conditions will prevail because we're getting rain right now, expecting something a little less than a quarter of an inch, decreasing rain overnight and tomorrow, and then picking up for an inch of rain or more on Saturday. And should be heavy rainfall locally today, and we are also under a wind advisory. Winds currently are out of the due south, light and variable, but will pick up in a couple of hours, shifting out of the southeast at 5 to 10 miles per hour, though that wind advisory in some areas will have gusts of 40 to 50 miles per hour. So what's up with that? All right, so winds will be out of the south-southeast tonight at 5 to 10 miles per hour and out of that direction and velocity tomorrow. Pollen is rated at none. The air quality index locally is in the good range at 36 parts per million. And the daytime UV index is low with a winter time UV of 1. Barometric pressure is holding steady at 29.97 inches. Visibility is down to 6 miles. And relative humidity is at 100%. We're swimming. We're swimming in it. Indeed. Weather from around the world is brought to you by people's personal weather stations that they purchased. These people planted these purchased personal weather stations somewhere on their property, and these people positively live around the world. London is 53 and mostly cloudy. Paris is 58 and sunny. Rome is 55 and partly cloudy. Kyiv is 41 and fair. Kabul is 40 and fair. Hong Kong is 62 and partly cloudy. Tokyo is 47 and cloudy. Sydney, Australia is 68 and partly cloudy. San Francisco, California is 51 degrees and cloudy. And New York is a crisp 19 degrees Fahrenheit and sunny. Oh, you have a freeze advisory if you didn't know. And that is weather from around the world, brought to you by people's personal weather stations that they purchased. These people planted these purchased personal weather stations somewhere on their property. And these people positively live around the world. Luisa Lopez and Karen Lema of Reuters brings us this first amuse-bouche here at the Chef's Table at West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. A Philippine court found top members of a political clan guilty of masterminding a 2009 massacre of 57 people, among them 32 journalists, in the country's worst single instance of election violence. And actually, it's in one of the world's worst instances. Members of three generations of the influential Amapatuan family were among those sentenced to life imprisonment on multiple counts of murder in a complicated verdict involving 101 defendants. The trial had been a crucial test of impunity in a country where provincial power is often decided by corruption, intimidation, and violence. Wow, that's what Trump wants. Weird, isn't it? The Ampatuan family, a dynasty in the southern province of Maguindano, had been accused of conspiring to ambush the convoy of a rival clan as it traveled to register its candidate for a gubernatorial election, an attack that spiraled into a bloodbath orchestrated by their own private army. Among the casualties were the wife and relatives of the rival candidate, lawyers, and 32 media workers who were executed beside a rural road in a volley of gunfire before being buried with their vehicles in a huge pit dug by an excavator. A court official read out a long list of names of those 101 defendants who were convicted, but some were acquitted due to lack of evidence. Some Ampatuan clan members were among those acquitted. The judge and lawyers decided to read only the last part of the verdict, agreeing that the 700-page decision could take an entire day. It was one of the world's single biggest attacks on journalists and has been the most anticipated verdicts in the Philippines, given the notoriety of the Ampatuan family and political ties that went all the way up to then-President Gloria Arroyo. It was closely watched as a test of whether democratic institutions in the Philippines could withstand pressure from money and powerful interests.
Je te donne ce mon amour pour la vie entière. La promesse de me trouver à tes genoux. Aussitôt que tu m'appelles, rester toujours fidèle. C'est tout. C'est tout. Je te donne tous mes printemps, mes étés de mai. Mes automnes, quand les feuilles tombent partout. Si ce n'est pas une bonne affaire, je te donne tous mes hivers, c'est tout.
Robert Mueller, no, not that Robert Mueller, but Robert Mueller of Reuters brings us this final amuse-bouche here at the chef's table at West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. Four suspects in the murder of a Slovak investigative journalist and his fiancee will go on trial in January after judges ruled just today that there was enough evidence to proceed in a case that has triggered mass protests against corruption. Jan Kusiak and Martina Kusnarova, both 27, were gunned down in their house outside the capital Bratislava in February of 2018. Prosecutors say entrepreneur Marian Kostner, a subject of Kusiak's reporting on fraud cases involving politically connected businessmen, had ordered his killing. The murder stoked widespread public anger and forced Prime Minister Robert Fico to resign. His ruling Schmear party faces a tight election this February 29th. The case is a test of Slovak judicial independence, given that the investigation exposed links between Kostner and police and public officials. All face up to life in prison if convicted. The panel of three judges rejected objections from defense lawyers who argued there were irregularities during the investigation and said the case should be returned for more evidence gathering. The judges said the main trial would start on January 13th instead. The court could impose a reduced sentence if any of the defendants confessed during the trial. Slovak media and Kusiak's family lawyer have said one of the accused admitted during the investigation to being the shooter. A fifth man, who will be tried separately, has confessed to facilitating the killing and has agreed to a plea deal with prosecutors to act as a witness. Well, that brings us to the end of our broadcast period for the day. But you do know that Netroots Radio is going to broadcast on, and we're going to meet up tomorrow for Blue Moon Spirits Fridays. Those French 77s will be tipped in honor of impeachment. Well, now won't it? Yes, indeed. So do stay tuned to Netroots Radio all day and all night for all the breaking news as it breaks. And we'll meet up here tomorrow, right here, in West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. Bon appetit.
Je voudrais du soleil vert, des dentelles et des théières, des photos de bord de mer, d'un mangeadin d'hiver. Je voudrais de la lumière, comme en Nouvelle-Angleterre. Je veux changer d'atmosphère, d'un mangeadin d'hiver. La pluie de novembre, tes mains qui courent, je n'en peux plus de t'attendre. Les années passent, il est loin, là je tombe. Nul ne peut nous entendre. Je voudrais du frais d'Astère, revoir un latte coët. Je voudrais toujours te plaire dans mon jardin d'hiver. Je veux déjeuner par terre comme au long de golf clair, t'embrasser les yeux ouverts dans mon jardin d'hiver. Dans mon jardin d'hiver.